Today we are continuing in our series called Shortcuts. Now, when it comes to our faith, God doesn't want us to take any shortcuts in that area. In fact, the Bible says that God would rather us be hot or cold rather than lukewarm. He doesn't want us to be in the middle. So we're going to learn today how we can build that faith, but also be all in when it comes to our faith in God. So take out your notes. Let's get ready to learn.
Ooh, good morning. You know, today, this morning we're going to talk about all in, and I don't know about you, but when I hear the words all in, there's something that I'm reminded of or something that comes to my mind, and I think many of us associate those words with poker. Now, all in poker means that you actually take all your chips, all your earnings, and you say, okay, based on the cards that you have, you're going to put everything in there. And what's interesting is it depends how much you have. If you have a lot, it's a risk, because if the other players have better cards than you, then you could lose. And if you have, but if you have better cards than them, then you win everything. Well, a couple years ago, a bunch of me and my friends, we were playing poker for fun. We weren't betting. I got to stress that. We weren't playing for money. We were playing for bragging rights. We wanted to see who would have the most. And so we're playing cards, and so I look at my cards, and I'm like, oh, all right. And so we're playing Texas Hold'em. And so I'm watching as the cards are being flipped over in Texas Hold'em. I'm like, oh. I had three of a kind. Now, there's all different, you know, it starts with nothing, then you have a pair, then you have two pairs, then three of a kind. So I had three of a kind, so I was like, hey, that's a pretty good hand. And because we weren't playing for money, we were playing for bragging rights, I was like, okay, more than likely, everybody's going to probably have like a pair or two pairs. So I'm going to go all in. So I remember I took all my chips and went, okay, here we go. And I'm like, all right. And I'm looking at everybody. And then other players were like, they'd fold, which means they don't want to compete. But somebody went, they go all in. I'll go all in too. And they had more chips than me. So I'm like, okay, all right, I'm going to win your chips. You're going to lose. And I'm confident. In fact, I wasn't confident. I was conceited. Okay, I was prideful. Because what I did next showed it. Because I took my two cards and I went, bam, I slammed it right on the table, right on the chips. And I'm like, three of a kind, yeah. And so I went to go grab it. And then I heard, oh, wait, try stop? Hold on. What? Yeah, you got three of a kind. I see that. But I got a full house. I like borrow and ship. Because I'm all in. I lost everything. And so, now, there's a reason why I want to share that. Now, normally, you wouldn't go all in with a three of a kind. Now, why did I go all in? Well, very simple. There was nothing to lose. Other than pride, which killed me anyway. But I had nothing to lose. And really, because, you know, we were playing for nothing, only bragging rights, I really didn't have anything to really gain. You see, this is what I learned. It's easy to go all in when nothing's going to cost as much. In other words, it's easy to go all in when you're not going to lose anything. It's easy to go all in. Because what happened was, after I went all in, because that player had majority of the chips now, it was only a matter of like 5-10 minutes, and then we said, okay, redistribute the chips, you're going to play again. But the question is, are we all in for Jesus? Are we all in, even though being all in for Jesus means we might lose a lot? See, Pastor Sheldon said in the video that today we're going to talk about being all in. And the Bible has one word that, to be completely honest, I don't like. Ever since I read this scripture, ever since I read what it meant, I never liked this word, and that word is lukewarm. I never liked that word. Because it means half-half. It means wishy-washy. And when it comes to being a Christian or a follower of Christ, that word, we don't want that. But the question is, are we all in? We're going to take a look at a video clip from the movie God's Not Dead 2. And in this movie, I'll give you guys the plot. I'm not going to spoil it, but in the plot is this. There's a teacher who in her class, a student asks a question, and she gives an answer that relates to Jesus. But because she's in a school setting, a public school setting, there's some offense that happens. And what actually happens is she gets suspended from teaching. And so what we're going to watch right now, and in fact, not only does she get suspended, but it actually goes farther than that. And we're going to take a clip. We're going to take a look at the clip where she's actually, the teacher is actually sitting with her attorney, and she's before the school board. And the school board is saying, okay, well, you know what? There's two choices. One choice is you can do this. You can do the easy thing and just apologize, say you're wrong, and you're good. Or we can fire you. And it's funny because in this clip, we're going to see whether or not this teacher who says she believes in Jesus, we're going to see whether this teacher is lukewarm or all in. Let's take a look. You know what I got from that? That sometimes the most easiest decision isn't the right one. See, when it comes to being all in, are we all in for Jesus, or are we choosing the easier side of being a Christian? And I think if we think I'm a Christian, but I'm going to do the easier side of being a Christian, or I'm going to take the easier path of following Christ, then to be honest, is it even the path of Christ? Because Jesus was all in. See, this morning, we're going to talk about what it means to be all in and how do we be all in for Jesus. The Bible says to be hot or cold, not lukewarm. When it comes to our faith in the Lord, there are no shortcuts. This morning, we're going to be encouraged to be all in when it comes to our faith in the Lord, because it is when we're all in that God tends to transform us in his glory. Revelation 3:15-16 says this, and this is the scripture that scares me. It's because it says, I know all the things you do, and this is God speaking. I know all the things you do, that you are neither hot or cold. I wish that you were one or the other. But since you are like lukewarm water, neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. I'm pretty sure we all don't want that. I don't want that. I want to be on fire for the Lord. So how do we do that? How do we be all in for Jesus? Well, the first thing is this. It starts with surrender. It starts with surrender. Being all in means we got to give up something. Romans 12:1-2, and many of us know this scripture, but I'm going to read it out of the Message translation, and it says it like this. So here's what I want you to do, God helping you. Take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for him. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what he wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. Can you do me a favor? Can you circle the God brings out the best? God brings the best out of you? See, God brings the best out of us, but in order for that to happen, we got to give him something to bring the best out of. In other words, if we want the best from God, then we got to be willing to give God us. We got to be willing to surrender. I remember when I was a kid, I was a kid. And so we went to Coconut Island one day, me and my family, my cousins, my auntie, guys were all there. And so many of us know that at Coconut Island, there's the tower. I was a little kid. And I was, you know, scared out of my mind about the tower because it's so far above the water. And then, you know, you have your older cousins who are telling you, hey, you're in Shark Cave underneath. You're in Shark Cave. And so I'm thinking to myself, wait, how many people are jumping off this tower and get Shark Cave underneath? How come I don't see when shark come? Argh! But I was a little kid, and I got freaked out. And so my cousin was like, come on, you can go. I was like, no. He's like, come on, no. Why, you chicken? No. Like, come on, let's go. Okay, so I go. Now, if you've ever been fearful of something, you probably, like, you start to be brave. So I was, you know, making my way to the tower going, yeah, all right, I'm gonna go on the tower. And as soon as you get there, kind of different, right? Because now it's like, it's about to happen. So I'm like, walking up the stair one by one, like this slow. And my cousin's like, come on, hurry up. I'm like, no. I'm getting there. Wait, relax. I'm gonna get there. Come on. And so he grabs me and pulls me up. And now I'm on the platform. And so he's like, okay, jump. What are you doing? Get shocked down there. I was just joking about the shark cave. You wasn't joking. No lie, you know when he's saying that's why I feel better. He's like, just jump. It's like, why? He's like, because it's so much fun. I'm like, not if I hit my head on that rock. And so I'm thinking to myself, I'm going to start freaking out. And so my cousin sees this. And he's like, are you going to jump? I'm like, no, I'm not going to jump. Really, you're not going to jump? I'm like, he goes, should I look at the edge one more time? I'm like, why? He's like, try to see. Make sure no more shark. Hey, no more shark. What? And he grabs me. And we both fall into the water because he throws me off the tower. And I just remember I'm like you're screaming, ah! And then I come up and I'm like, I'm all mad. I'm like, why are you pushing me? Why are you pushing me? And he's like, did you have fun? Yeah. Like, do him again. Yeah, just don't push me this time. Say, okay, go. And so I went. And so ever since that, I had no problem jumping off the tower. Now, fast forward the tape, and then one of my friends, who's extremely scared of heights, said the same thing to me. Oh, I don't like jumping off the tower because it's too high. And I'm like, no, come on. And I did the exact same thing to her. I was like, should I go look at the edge? Nah, it's not that far. Should I look? And then I just pushed her off. Now, you're going to think, oh, you're a pastor, you're mean. First of all, I wasn't a pastor back then, so hey, it's okay. But second, here's why I did it. Because I asked her the same thing after. I asked her, so what, was fun, huh? She's like, yeah. I was like, no problem, right? Yeah. No need to be scared anymore, right? Yeah. Okay, and then she kept going. The reason why I did that to her is because I experienced it. I experienced everything she was going through, the fear, making sure I don't get eaten by a shark, making sure I don't crack my head on the rock, all these things. But then I also experienced the joy of when I finally jumped off. And I wanted her to experience the same thing. See, I think sometimes we're so willing to hold on to our lives because we're scared. And we're not ready to surrender to God. But the reality is God is saying, I want you all in. Because when you're all in, you get to experience what I have for you. The best way I can also explain this is in our youth ministry, we do this exercise. We do this exercise once in a while where we take a ladder. Don't worry, we're safe about it. And so we take a ladder, and we have kids climb it. And we have a bunch of people, and they're right behind, and they're bracing, and we tell the kid to fall off the ladder, to let go of the ladder. And let me share with you, there was one Sunday, we did this, and it's funny because, you see, we like to take the brave kids, you know, the kids that they think they all, you know, macho and all this and that. And so we take them. And so we tell them, climb the ladder. And so they climb the ladder. And you know what's really interesting is when you tell them to let go. Majority of them don't. They plead with me, this is too high, I can come down one more. Sure. And they come down. And then they go, oh, I can come down one more. Brother, pretty soon you can be on the ground. I'll just fall. But I'll never forget this one Sunday. We asked one of our kids to go up. And I know this kid's story. I know he's gone through a lot physically. I know his health isn't the greatest. He's been in and out of the hospital. And something I believe is the Lord, I told him, climb the ladder. Mind you, I've asked other kids before him, and they all said no. They all came down the ladder. And so I asked him to climb the ladder, and I had him go pretty high. And I told him, let go. And so he's holding onto the ladder, and he's bending over, and I'm thinking to myself, oh, my goodness. And I hear him crying. And I'm thinking to myself, oh, my goodness, I just made this kid cry. And so I'm telling him, you know what? You don't have to do it. You can come down. You know, I don't want you to feel like this and all that. And his sister is right in front of him. And this is what she does. She goes, wait, he's praying right now. I'm like, what? He's praying. And she smiles at me. And I look at him and say, you ready to let go? He says, sure. He lets go. And we catch him. You know what's amazing is that the moment that we let go in that free fall, you know what happens when we do that, when that happens? You know what happens when that boy let go of that ladder and we caught him? You know what he experienced? Faith. Because he was willing to surrender. He was willing to let go. He was willing to say, Lord, I believe in you, not just a part, I'm all in. See, if we're not all in, we're going to miss the experiences of life that God wants us to have. And the truth is, there are experiences of joy as well as pain that we will experience when we're all in. And it's mostly during these experiences that we're going to see God work in our lives. See, when we're not all in, what actually happens is we hold on to that ladder. And if you were to hold on to that ladder for all your days and all your nights, eventually you're going to become like the ladder and not experience the life that God has for you. God wants to transform us from the conformities of this world. See, I think for many of us, including myself, there's parts in my life where I'm saying, I'm holding on to the world rather than trusting in God and saying, I'm going to let go of this so I can grab onto God. And the reality is, for some of us, we're struggling with, wait, God, I like this, but I know you want this. And that's a really interesting concept, because imagine this. Imagine if you're in this hand, you were to say, this is what I like. This is the world. This is my own selfish or my own flesh things that I like. This is the things of the world that I like. And this is this hand right here. And in this hand, you got what God wants. Now imagine both hands are tied to an 18-wheeler and they go the opposite way. What's going to happen? You're going to die. You see, the reality is we can't have both. We cannot say, hey, yeah, I'm a Christian. I believe in Jesus, but I'm doing this too. That's not what Jesus wants. That's not what being all in is. There's a word for that, and I'm gonna say it, and hopefully it doesn't offend anybody, but that's a hypocrite. That's what Jesus warned us against. He said we're not supposed to be like that. We're not supposed to be like the hypocrites. We're supposed to be followers of him. You look at all his disciples, we have to be all in just like them. One paid the price. He said, I'm not all in, and he gave his life. We gotta be all in. See, we think of surrender as, oh, we gotta let go. But the reality is, when it comes to surrendering to God, it means we're letting him in. We're letting him in. And when we're all in, we invite God into all the areas of our lives so that he can do great things in and through us. Don't think of it, oh, I got to surrender, so I'll go, oh, God, I got to let go of all this stuff. No, don't look at it like that. Look at it as, God, I'm going to surrender all this so that I can let you in. I'm making room in my life, saying, shoot, bye, kicking it to the curb, taking it to the trash, so that I can have the treasure of heaven in my life. That's what it means to be all in. See, there's one man who experienced this life of surrender, and his name is Joshua. Joshua is actually one of two people of the 12 spies that Moses sent to scout the promised land. But Joshua and Caleb, the other guy, were the only two that actually got to set foot in the promised land. They were the only two. And I love what Joshua says in Joshua 3:5. Joshua told the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. That word consecrate, it means to make or declare sacred, set apart or dedicate to God. And I think for many of us, we want to do amazing things for God. And while that's well-intentioned, the truth is that's God's role. See, the truth is, many of us, we say, hey, God, I want to do a lot for you. I want to do a lot. I want to do a lot. But the reality is, it's actually God's role. God is actually the one saying, I want to do a lot in you. Not the other way around. You surrender your life to me, I get to do great things in you. See, the other 10 spies that went along with Joshua and Caleb, they were so overwhelmed by the people that inhabited the promised land that they forgot to see the God that promised the land to them. Joshua and Caleb knew that it would be God, not them. Joshua knew that it would be God, not them, that would conquer the promised land. See, I think there's times in our lives where we think being all in is us, and it is. But it's us making room for him by surrendering. When our oldest daughter, Caitlin, was born, after Katie came out of the hospital with our daughter, Katie was in so much pain that the doctors gave her pain medicine. And we questioned the doctors because we were like, because the way that we were feeding Caitlin, was it gonna go through Katie's system and affect Caitlin? And the doctor said no. Well, after we brought Caitlin home, we noticed that Caitlin wasn't really responding, that she was lethargic. And so because of this concern, we took her to the ER the next day. I think literally the day after we came out of the hospital, we went right back in because Caitlin wasn't responding. She was breathing, she was breathing. But she was sleeping, her eyes were closed, she wasn't crying, she wasn't responding like how a normal newborn would react. And so I remember we're in the ER, and this is our first child, so we had everybody in the ER with us. We had my parents, we had Katie's parents, we had Katie's grandparents, and so we're all in there. And then the doctor says, we gotta give Caitlin an IV. Now, prior to our daughter, I knew nothing about babies, okay? I was actually afraid of babies more than they were afraid of me. And so the doctor comes in, and I think the nurse comes in, and they're getting ready to do the IV. Now, I'm not putting it on me because I know it wasn't me, but everybody else in the room, you have Katie, you have Katie's parents, Katie's father is a former paramedic, but at that time was a paramedic. There you go. But everyone in there, and so the doctor's saying, you got to hold down your child. Now everybody's overwhelmed, and I so was I. Everybody's overwhelmed. Everybody's crying and tearing up in the ER. And out of nowhere, I said, okay, I'll do it. And I just remember holding Caitlin on the bed, I'm just saying, it's okay, it's okay. They administer IV, she'd cry. And I'd be like, it's okay, you're fine, you're fine. You're fine, you're okay. And I looked around and I was like, why am I the only one in here not crying? Because truth is, I'm the biggest crybaby of them all. This is my daughter, I should be the one really crying. And I realized it wasn't me. It was the Lord saying, let me take over so that you can be her strength. And not just for her, but for everybody else. I had to surrender. Otherwise, there wouldn't have been a clear thought. No one would be able to hold down Caitlin because we'd be all overwhelmed with our emotions. And I remember thinking that. And I remember going, Lord, you're such an amazing God. And it was so awesome because they figured out what was wrong. And Caitlin is now a 3-year-old acting like she's 13. And it's just an amazing thing. And I look at it, it's like, Lord, if I didn't surrender, if I didn't. And it was interesting because what God was actually saying in this moment, are you all in? Are you going to rely on you? Or are you going to rely on me? Are you going to let me give you the strength? Or are you going to rely on your own strength? Are you going to rely on your emotions? Are you going to rely on yourself? Or are you willing to say, God, I can't do this, so you take over? And it's the same way with us. We got to be willing to surrender so that God can do great things. See, consecration is all about removing us from the throne and making sure that Jesus is on the throne of our lives. See, it's all of you for all of him. And it starts with surrendering our hearts to Jesus, knowing that as we surrender to him, he's going to do great things in and through us. And the second thing is this. When it comes to being all in, it continues with commitment. It continues with commitment. Galatians 6:9 says it like this. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. You see, Jesus is inviting you to be all in, to be more than just a fan of his, but to be a follower of his. And while it starts with surrender, it continues with being committed. Now, I use that word a lot. I use it a lot in my messages. I use it a lot when I speak to people about fan and follower because the reality is there's a difference between being a fan and being a follower. Fans stay in the stands. Followers step up. Fans, they love to cheer, while followers, they seek to listen. Fans pursue according to convenience, but followers pursue out of commitment. Fans experience the moment, but followers are invited to experience the lifetime. See, when it comes to our faith, are we fans or are we followers? When it comes to Jesus, are we fans or are we followers? Growing up, before I liked football, my favorite sport was basketball. And so I love basketball. I grew up in the Michael Jordan era, so I love watching Michael Jordan, Space Jam, one of my favorite movies. And I just loved basketball. So when I'd play with my friends, we'd play basketball. Now, over time, as I got older, as I grew up from kid to teenage years, I still loved basketball. I still played my basketball. You know, we played pickup games, and I just enjoyed it. I just loved playing basketball. I still do. But I remember one time, my friends who all played on actual teams, on real teams, I remember one time asking my friend, hey, I like join your guys' team. How do I join your guys' team? And so he invited me. He's like, hey, you want to come to one of our practices? I was like, sure. And I think I was like 13. And so I went, and now I wasn't a skinny kid, as you can tell. So I watched their practice, and I'm seeing all their running. I'm seeing all their drills and all that. And I was like, oh, that's cool. But at that time, I wasn't able to join because my mom said no at the time. But then you go into high school. And I'll never forget this. So high school, basketball tryouts start up. And I'm like, shoots. And so my friend's like, you should probably go to conditioning. And I was like, nah, I don't need. I'm okay. Yeah, I should have went to conditioning. So we go to tryouts. And so I know a lot of, because a lot of my friends were playing basketball. In fact, some of the stats people were my friends as well. And so we get there. We're doing our tryouts in the old UH gym. And so I remember we were doing all the drills, and this is where I learned that I should have done conditioning, because as we're doing the drills, I'm gasping for air, doing layups like that. And then the coach says, okay, we're going to scrimmage. So I'm like, yes, I love it when we scrimmage, because I know that means we're just going to play basketball. We don't got to do drills. Okay. Now, this is where I knew I was a fan. This is where the Lord, I think, spoke to me even before I really had a relationship with him. That he said, you're a fan of basketball, not a follower. Because the coach said, we're going to play shirts versus skins. Skins. Skin. Coach. Skin. He's like, yep, take your shirt off. okay. Now, after that first initial shock, I was okay. And then as we started scrimmaging, I realized that, Ben, you're a fan of basketball, not a follower. Because fans allow their bodies to look the way they do yours does as you're running up and down the court. Followers look like your friends who, as they're running up and down the court, they're not dying. Like, I think eventually in one of the part while we were scrimmaging, I think I just stayed at the basket. Hey guys, just throw me the ball, guys. Just throw me the ball. And the truth is, I am a fan of basketball, but I'm not a follower. You know who's a follower of basketball? LeBron James. You know how I can tell you that? Try asking him to play basketball. He can. And not only can he play basketball, but he's dedicated to it. He's dedicated to putting in the time to train. See, when it comes to being a fan or follower, the question we got to ask is, which one are we? See, Jesus said this. He said, come follow me. In other words, are you willing to be all in and be more than just a fan? Are you willing to commit to being his follower and let him impact your life? You see, it's not just about walking by faith, but by following in faith. It's about being committed to believing in Jesus in such a way that it's evident in our lives. In the book of Daniel, we hear three young men. Some of us know them. Their names are Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three young men, they weren't just fans of God. They were followers. And it was evident in their lives. And here's what happens. The king issues a decree saying that you need to bow down to this statue that I have created, to this idol that I have created. And for those who do not, well, you're going to pay the price, and that's death. And so Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're not fans of God, they're followers. So they hear the king's decree, and they say, no, sorry, we're gonna still worship our God because we're not fans, we're followers. And the king finds this out, and he orders for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to come towards him so he can ask them, because he's ready and willing to say, you know what, if you're not going to bow down, if you're not going to listen to me, then you're going to pay the price. And this is what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered, and I love it. This is how you can tell they're actually like, they're teenagers. Because Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. But even if he doesn't, we want to make it clear to you, your majesty, that we will never serve your gods or worship the gold statue that you have set up. That's to the king. Imagine saying that to the president. Ah! See, the reality is, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego weren't fans. They didn't just say, oh, yeah, I love Jesus. Oh, I love God. No, they were fans to the point where the king stands before them ready to kill them. And they say straight up, sorry, we're not going to do it. We believe in God, and therefore we're going to worship him. And we believe in him so much that we believe he's going to rescue us. But even if he doesn't, we're still going to do it. Why? Because we're followers of God. And so what does the king do? Does the king change his heart? No! He throws him into the fire. And I love this. He throws him into the fire. The fire is so hot that the guards that open the furnace door die instantly because of the heat. And so they throw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fire. And they close the door. Instantly, they should have died. But as they look, as the king looks in, he says, didn't we throw in three guys? And his guards are saying, yeah. Then why do I see another one? And this guy looks like the Son of God. And then he orders the door to be open. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego come out. And this is the craziest part. They come out of the furnace, not even smelling like smoke. And then the king changes the decree. The king changes his heart. See, I honestly believe that the king wouldn't have changed his heart had Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego not been followers. Because followers of Jesus show their faith in such a way that it becomes evident in their lives. See, these guys weren't committed to their faith in God only because it was comfortable or convenient. They didn't just say they believed. Their commitment was in the face of persecution and death, and they showed their proof of their faith. They were willing to risk their lives. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were all in for God, and in the end, their faith in God allowed the king to see the glory of God. There was one Wednesday night years ago, and I know I think I shared this before, but I want to share it again. There's a Wednesday night a couple years ago that me and my friends, we went down to Subway, and we're eating in front of Subway, and we're talking about church. We just came from church. It was a Wednesday night. And so we're talking about church, and we notice this guy make his way into Baskin Robbins. And as he makes his way into Baskin Robbins, we're talking loud. I mean, we're young adults. And so he's walking past us as he enters Baskin Robbins, and he looks at us, and the look he gives us is like this. Like, what are you guys talking about? And so we're talking, and I notice him. I can feel his eyes, and literally, he's in Baskin Robbins, and he's looking at us. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, this guy is either weird or weird. But I'm noticing him, and I see him looking, and all of a sudden, he pops the door open, and he says, "You guys really believe in that God stuff?" Now, we're young adults, and we could have easily said, sorry. We could have done that. But we were young adults, so we were really, arrogant. And we're like, yeah, we believe in God. And so he comes out of Baskin Robbins, and he goes, "You guys really believe in God? You really believe in Jesus? You really believe in all that stuff?" And he starts arguing with us. He starts arguing with us in the front of Subway. And I'm like, dude, I just want to eat my sandwich. But we're all talking about it, and we're like, yeah, we believe in God. Yeah, he's really throwing out some really good questions. He's like, so you're saying that there's heaven, there's eternal life. We're like, yeah. He's like, I don't believe that. That's dumb. And we're like, well, what if we're right? And so we just start answering, and we're trying our best, because I can feel the blood boiling in us, and we're trying our hardest to, because we just came from church, and trying so hard to just like give them the answers and just keep our hearts good. And all of a sudden, in the midst, as I think we're about to just erupt, this guy looks at us and he says, "Well done, good and faithful servants. Well done." And we're like, "Wait, what? Huh?" He's like, "Yeah, I too believe in God. I think he actually said, I'm a pastor." And he said, "The Bible says you got to be ready in and out of season. You guys could have easily said, you guys don't believe. Or you guys could have said, sorry. You guys could have said all that stuff. You could have even just been quiet. But you stood up. You were committed. Well done." And he walked back into Baskin Robbins. And all of us together on the table were like, "Did that just happen? Like, that's crazy." And then he walks out and he says, "You guys have a blessed night, and continue to serve God." And the best part was the lady from Baskin Robbins comes out and says, "Hey, that guy just paid for ice cream for all of you guys." That wasn't the best part. The best part was the fact that we saw. We could have easily said, "You know what, it's not convenient for us, it's not comfortable." It wasn't comfortable at all. And we could have just said anything else. But we're proud of our God. We're proud of the fact that we love him and that he loves us. We're not afraid to say we believe in him. See, being all in starts with surrender, it continues with commitment. And the third part is this: it leads to sacrifice. It leads to sacrifice. Luke 9:23-25, Jesus said this: "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and is himself destroyed or lost? You know, one of the reasons why people are lukewarm in their faith is because they don't like sacrifice. We don't want to risk losing our lives or part of it for Jesus. Being all in with Jesus means that we're going to live our lives just as Jesus did, which means that we're going to face the same things Jesus did, and which means we're going to have to sacrifice our lives just as Jesus did. Now, sacrificing our lives doesn't mean physical death. It doesn't mean bodily hurt or pain, but it does mean that something is going to have to die in us so that Christ can come alive in us. And that's what take up our cross means. You see, the problem we have is that we look so hard at what we're going to sacrifice than rather looking at the why. See, when we look at why we sacrifice, it's so much easier to sacrifice. Funny story, back in the day, there was a spruce up, and after the spruce up, me and a bunch of us young people were here, and we were hanging out, and we decided to play capture the slipper. And we decided to play capture the slipper on the playground right here, the kids' playground, the jungle gym. And so we're playing, and I liked Katie. I liked Katie at this time. And so we're playing capture the slipper. Katie's on my team. And so she gets out, okay? And so she gets out, she's out, and she needs somebody to tag her. And so I'm like, hey, I like Katie, right? I like Katie, you know. And so I'm like, in my mind, what's playing in my mind is, oh, I'm going to be a hero. I'm going to save her. So I'm running towards her, okay? And literally, in my mind, in my head, there's music going on like, dun, 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 dun. And I'm running, and I'm trying to dodge, you know, everybody trying to tag me. Trying to be all ninja and all that. And so I finally go. Now, this is the best part. That's why I know God loves humor. It's because I'm thinking that, right? And I'm like, I see her. And all of a sudden, I'm trying to be heroic, and all of a sudden, I fall. Boom! Like I tripped on something. Now, I tripped on something. I got back up, and then everybody else tagged me, so I'm out. And so I'm walking down. I'm going to where she's at because she's in the out zone. And I'm like, my foot is sore. Like, for real, my foot is sore. I'm walking. And so, you know when you bang your toe like that, right? You know, it hurts, right? You bang your pinky toe. It's like, ah, it hurts really bad. What's going on? So I look at my toe, and I'm like, oh, there's blood. Huh. I look. There's a gash. Now, I'm going to say it. Hopefully, it doesn't make you guys queasy. But I almost ripped my pinky toe off. And so I'm like looking there, and I'm thinking, now, like, I'm trying to be brave because, you know, Katie's still there. So I'm like, yeah, just on Band-Aid. Just give me a Band-Aid. So I put on Band-Aid, and the blood is, like, going past the Band-Aid. And so someone sees me, and they're like, what are you doing? I'm like, ah, you're on a little cut. You're on a little cut. I show them, like, right here. Like, oh, bro, you got to go ER, And luckily we had somebody here who was a nurse, and so she looked at me, and she's like, let me see a cut. I was like, nah, it's just small. And she looked at me like, she ran, she grabbed gauze, I was like, what are you doing? It's just a little cut. She's like, no. You got to go to the ER. You need stitches. Now, prior to this, I never had stitches, and I was like, but luckily, it all went good. I still get my baby toe, and I laughed with Katie to this day. I go, babe, I just like, you know, this is how much I love you. I almost didn't sacrifice my baby toe because I love you. And you know, the reality is, the reason why I did that, the reason why I ran towards her is because I loved her. See, when we look at why we sacrifice, so much easier to look at what we sacrifice. I think I would have been okay if I had lost my baby toe. I'm just saying, Lord. But when we look at why we sacrifice, it's so much easier than what. And this is something that a young man in the Bible missed out on. In Luke 18:18-23, it says it like this. Now a certain ruler asked him, Jesus, saying, "Good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" So Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but one, and that is God. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother." And the young ruler said, "All these things I have kept from my youth." So when Jesus heard of these things, he said to him, "You still lack one thing. Sell all that you have and distribute to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me." But when he heard this, he became very sorrowful, for he was very rich. You see, sometimes we have the same problem as this young ruler, that we're not willing to let go of the things we have for what God has for us. See, the reality is this. This ruler had the opportunity to walk with Jesus physically, but he turned it down because he wasn't willing to give up his riches. You know, he may not have been willing to give up his riches, but he gave up being rich. And another problem that the young ruler had was that he thought he was good enough. He was following the commandments. He thought that, hey, I do all these things. I'm good enough, right? I can inherit eternal life, right? And the reality is many people are on the fence with being all in because they feel like they can't follow all the rules in the Bible. But you know, the truth is that it's not about being all in by following rules in the Bible. It's being all in by following Jesus. See, what we choose to sacrifice will ultimately show the condition of our heart. Who we sacrifice for reveals who ultimately holds our heart. That's why Jesus said it like this in Luke 27. He got asked, "What is the greatest commandment in the world?" And Jesus answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." When Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength," what he was actually saying is, you gotta be all in. You gotta be all in. You know, growing up, I only had a mom. And growing up as an only child with only a mom raising you, you know, I loved my mom. I love my mom tremendously. She's such an amazing woman. But I remember there was my teenage years where I started kind of getting, you know, argumentative with her and started kind of rebelling. And so I remember, you know, pretty much all my life, I was a good kid. You know, I love my mom. I had no problem showing how much I love my mom. And then you become a teenager, and it's like everybody calls you mama's boy, and you're like, I don't want mama's boy. And so I tried to rebel, and I tried to say, I'm not a mama's boy. And so I argued against my mom, and I'd just be really combative, and I'd be like, you know, mom, you don't know what you're talking about and all this. And I'm pretty sure I hurt her along the way. There's some moments I know I probably hurt her. And then after I came to know Jesus there were still issues that we were dealing with. Someone said, "Man, you're such a mama's boy. You listen to your mom a lot. Like, you're such a mama's boy." And I looked at them, and I thought I was going to say, "I'm not a mama's boy." And instead, what came out of my mouth was, "I am a mama's boy. Why wouldn't I be? I love my mom. And I'm not ashamed of it." You know, it's funny. It's because I thought that was something to be shamed for. But the reality is that's the truth. See, I don't think you could be all in loving someone and yet be ashamed of them. Like, for example, I love my wife. I love Katie. And she drives me crazy sometimes. There's times where she does something and I'm just like, "Oh, Lord. Oh." And I'm reminded I love her, though. I'm all in my love with her. I'm not ashamed. I just end up laughing with her. See, I think we got to come back to that. I think we got to remember that when it comes to, if I love Jesus, I'm not ashamed to declare my love for him. I'm not going to be ashamed to declare my love by living my life for him. See, this morning, when it comes to our faith in Jesus, are we all in or are we going through the motions? We can believe in Jesus. We can go to church. We can pray. We can read the Bible. But are we just going through the motions, or are we willing to surrender, commit, and sacrifice our lives for him? You know, some people look at their circumstances in life and then decide where their faith lies. But for those who are all in for Jesus, they look at where their faith is no matter what the circumstances. There's a singer, a Christian artist by the name of Matthew West, and some of you might hear his songs if you listen to Caleb, if you listen to Christian music. He's written, he sings a lot of songs. Well, there's a time in his life where he had to question himself. Was he just going through the motions, or was he really all in for Jesus? Was his relationship with Jesus all in, or was it just something that looked good? And what came out of it was this song. Where we're going to watch right now is we're going to watch the music video. And in this music video, you're going to actually see what happened, the situation that he went through, and how he chose to not be about the motions, but be all in. Let's take a look. This morning, I want to ask you that question. What if we really gave everything? What if you and I were willing to say, you know what? I'm not going to be half in, half out. I'm not going to be wishy-washy. I'm not going to be lukewarm. When it comes to my relationship with Jesus, when it comes to my faith in God, it's not who I want to be. I want to give everything. I'm willing to give everything. Because the truth is, God is my everything. The way I can best say it is like this. It's like right now I believe this, that there is a line drawn in the sand for you and I this morning. And just like on this stage, there's a line. And here, this is where we're at right now. Our lives right now. Some of it may be good. Some of it may not be so good. You might be here and maybe you're on the fence of, do I even want to believe? Do I want to have a relationship with God? Some of you might be here and you say, well, I believe in God, but I do all the things and I'm okay with that. There's a line drawn in the sand for you and I this morning. And if you listen closely, you'll hear three words. You'll hear the voice of our Lord and Savior saying, come follow me. But Lord, it's scary. I don't know what's on that side. I'm safe on this side. I'm okay. I'm comfortable. It's convenient. Come follow me. What's on that side? And then we look up and realize it's not what's on that other side. It's who. We take that step to be all in. Because that's where God wants us. Amen. Would you bow your heads with me this morning? Lord, we come to you. And Lord, I know I've been here. I've been on this side of the line. I've been scared. I've been fearful. I've been comfortable. Lord, I know for many of us, we feel the same way. But Lord, the truth is, we don't want to be anywhere that you're not. And Lord, as you have drawn a line in the sand for us this morning, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would speak, that you'd speak your spirit of courage, of boldness. That for those who are wondering if this is worth it, is it worth having a relationship with you? Is it worth giving up the comfort of their lives and risk it all and be all in for the life that you have? Lord, I pray that you would speak to them. And as you say to follow you, Lord, we together would cross, we're all in. That no matter what the circumstances, no matter what the trials, we want to be where you're at. That's our prayer, Lord. Some of you might be here, and maybe the Lord is saying the first step you need to take over that line is trusting him with your life to receive him as your Lord and Savior. And so I'm going to ask, with everybody's eyes closed, I'm going to ask you to repeat a prayer after me. I'm going to say the words, but you add the heart. Lord Jesus, I take the first step to receive you as my Lord and Savior, that I believe you died on the cross and that you rose again because you love me. Because you love me, you want all of me. So let me move closer to you because I want to be where you are. And I want the life that you have for me. I thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. With everybody's eyes closed and heads bowed, I'm going to ask that you would raise your hand. But I would also ask, actually, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. I'm going to ask for you to be bold and courageous, because that's what it's going to take to be all in. If you said that prayer for the very first time, I'm going to ask you to stand as an act of faith, saying, Lord, I declare that I'm all in. Many of us, we have a relationship with God. We have a relationship with the Lord. But we're playing it safe. And Lord, that's not what we want. We want to say, Lord, we're willing to cross the threshold to be with you. We're not going to be lukewarm anymore. And so if that is you this morning, I'm going to ask you to stand, to be bold and courageous, just as Joshua was, just as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That we are saying we're going to be bold. We're not going to be lukewarm. That when we cross this line, we mean it. Because Jesus was all in for us. Lord, you see the hearts of your people. And I pray, Lord, that as we stand, Lord, as for those who stand and for those who are standing in their hearts, Lord, I pray that this would be a moment we never forget. That this would be the moment we say we're not going to be lukewarm. We're going to be exactly who you want us to be, followers of you. And Lord, we look forward to what you are going to do in our lives now and forevermore. So we thank you, Lord. We put our faith, hope, and love in you. And thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, and the church would say, amen, amen, amen. If you made the decision to accept Jesus Christ, if you took that first step,